Here's me in my motor, in sunny Greenock, in Inverclyde, by the water, where I'm going to be doing my show. Soon I'm doing rehearsals in there, 10 to 10, 10 to 10, 10 in the morning to 10 at night, these rehearsals, can you believe it? I'm getting destroyed by this. But what I have been enjoying doing when I'm getting in late at night, after my long drive home, is playing Gran Turismo 7. Sticking that on and chilling out. I was quite interested by the reviews for GT7. Some of the reviews obviously spoke of it very highly. Some other reviews were a bit middling. A wee bit of complaints about how it was laid out, how kind of boring and kind of stark it was in places. I was quite surprised by the reviews, because the thing I've been really enjoying about Gran Turismo 7 is that kind of clean simplicity and how relaxing the game is. I'll tell you what I'm a fan of doing, right? I am a fan, and this drives my wife mad, right? It doesn't really drive her mad, that's just a saying, that's a thing people say, and it drives my wife mad, this doesn't actually drive her mad. She's occasionally went to me, "Oh, is that you put your wee cafe on again?" Because I like to stick on YouTube on the big telly a jazz cafe thing. It's like a, let me describe it, it's almost like an animated looping image of that somebody's drawn of a cafe somewhere, and smooth kind of jazz plays, but no, just laid on top of it. Smooth jazz plays, it sounds like you're sitting in the cafe listening to the smooth jazz. And when I started playing Gran Turismo 7, and obviously the driving is as good as it's ever been, I love all that stuff. I love all the kind of wee driving tests and stuff like that in Gran Turismo. It just really speaks to me, that stuff. It wasn't that long ago I did my driving test. But when I saw that there was a wee cafe you could go to, that you could actually go to a wee cafe and sit and listen to some smooth jazz and talk to guys about your motors while you were in this wee breezy cafe, and it was all weird and kind of slow and gentle, I fucking love that, man. I love it. I love that. There's something, I love Japanese games, right? And this Gran Turismo game is so Japanese. And it's like when you compare something like GT7 to Forza Horizon, which I'm not really a fan of. Like, I get with Forza that it's amazing looking. The graphics are amazing and it's high octane and it's thrilling and stuff, but see that thing in Forza where it feels like you're barely even steering your motor. You're barreling so fast as fuck, and you're just getting wee nudges to the motor to skid it round corners and stuff like that. And then you've got a guy hooting and hollering in your ear. He's like, "Yeehaw, you're the greatest, man. Everybody was right about you. You're the fucking greatest driver in the world. You're amazing, dude. It was true. The rumors were true. Oh, man, you're so cool." I don't fucking want that. I don't want that. I get enough of that in real life. I don't want to hear guys shouting that at me. Fucking hooting and hollering in my fucking ear for hours while I'm just wanting to drive my motor and everything's so fucking loud and the music's pumping and all that. And I'm like, fucking give me peace. With a game like Forza Horizon, I don't even feel like I'm playing it. But with Gran Turismo 7, I'm having to very carefully turn one corner. "Here you go, pal. Try and take this motor round that one corner there and get over the finish line in this amount of time." And I go, "Well, alright, how hard can it be?" And you fucking go, drive, you skid off. You go, drive, you get there too late. You're like, what the fuck, there's nobody shouting in your ear, "Whoa, you're the best, man, you're the fucking amazing." Actually, people are gently saying into your ear, "You're not very good at turning corners, are you, pal? You're not very good at turning corners in your wee motor, are you? Why don't you come to the wee cafe, listen to some smooth jazz, wind down a wee bit. I'll tell you a wee bit about that Volkswagen Beetle you're driving while you're having a wee java. Then you can go back out and try and turn that corner again." That is what I'm wanting for a driving game. That's what I'm wanting for games. I'm wanting a kind of sense of identity And Gran Turismo understands its own identity. And a lot of other racing games, man, they all kind of merge into a hole for me. They all kind of merge into the same fucking hooting and hollering, noisy fucking crashing about. Your fingers never off the right trigger. That's what they kind of feel like to me, whereas Gran Turismo steps back into the ring and goes, get your fucking finger off that accelerator. Get your foot on the brake. Take that corner. Have a coffee. Buy a motor. Now, I suppose we need to talk about the buying of the motors things and the real money hanging on that, right? It's just not an issue for me. And I know it's annoying when people say it's just not an issue for me. I know it's annoying when people go, well, it doesn't bother me. So, look, all that stuff is ugly, right? It's ugly. I don't like it. Fundamentally, I don't like it when games allow you to spend real money to do stuff in the game. I don't really like it. I get it when it's like an MMO or something. I get it when it's a lifestyle game, in a sense. And Gran Turismo, you can see, is trying to lean towards being a lifestyle game, but I kind of don't think it is. I think it's... that's the one element of its identity that I think it is confused about. It is not a lifestyle game. But it wants to be. It wants to slow your progress. It wants to slow you down. But what they should never have done is allow you to spend real money on it. However, I've been playing it, happily playing it. I've been racking up the money. I've been able to buy cars. But I've had to think carefully about the cars I'm buying. And I like that as well. I like the fact that you have to deliberate when you go to that used car lot. You need to go, well, I've been looking at that one for a while and it's there, good price, should I get it? But then it's going to be a while before I can buy another motor. That's fine, man. That's the pace of the game. That's fine, but they should have brought real money into it. And, you know, it's fucking annoying. And particularly when they did that patch thing where it seemed like people said they'd kind of slowed down the progress again, but it's hard to properly parse that when you're no deep into it like that, when you're no looking for that stuff. Me, I just think it's a beautiful game. It's like the perfect driving game for me. No racing game, but driving game, the perfect one for me, because it's just a huge pleasure to... I know nothing about cars, right? This motor, I'm in. My wife picked it. I drive it. I can drive. I can only drive automatic motors. I only have an automatic license. I just don't fucking understand why you would use gears. Why would you fucking use a clutch? I don't get it. Why would you use extra? Why would you want extra controls? It's like with computer games, it's like, why would you add an extra button that you need to press to do a fucking thing that you can do with just two buttons? I don't get it. The guy who likes games in me doesn't get why you would want to drive a manual car. But I get that people that are into motors like all that stuff. They like to be able to, you know, I'm going to shift my gear and that now. But, I like driving my motor around like it's a wee Mario Kart. I know nothing about motors, man. You know what I mean? I just like having a wee shot in them, and I like how certain ones look. And Gran Turismo lets me climb into a motor, admire how it looks, try and turn the corner in it, then go to a cafe, have a wee coffee, and have some old cunt tell me about how smart I was to buy that motor for the used car salesman. I think it's a beautiful game. Astonishing. And I remember sending the boys, Ryan and Jerry, a wee clip of the fucking opening titles. The game is gentle and beautiful and fucking totally off its head as well. Like, it's off its head. There was like space exploration and fucking Beatles and all that in the opening title. Like, what was going on? I love it. I absolutely love it. So if you've hesitated at all in picking up your Gran Turismo, hesitate no longer. If the thoughts or the money stuff has been putting you off, fucking don't worry about it, man. Just climb in your motor and drive. Don't even think about it. Don't even think about it. It's something you don't even need to worry about. And there's a lovely wee mode where you can put your motor in real life locations to take photos at. You know, like when you get a new girlfriend and you kind of just want to take photos at her all the time, and you're like, let's go to the Botanic Gardens. But actually, you're thinking, because I want to take some beautiful photos of you walking through the Botanic Gardens, or let's go to this park, or let's go to Paris, and I'll take a photo in front of the Eiffel Tower, just like that, except with motors. Much sadder, but still very satisfying. Catchies. I'm away to turn my corner. How do you get the instruction manual?
Tunnock, I think that's how you pronounce it, is available on Xbox Game Pass. And despite it being on Xbox Game Pass, I still feel like asking for some kind of refund. No, because it isn't a really beautiful, very impressively put together. This is pages of a manual that you find as you're moving through the game that explains things to you. Just impeccably designed game. No, I would like a refund because I was looking for a kind of cutesy indie game to play to take my mind off the horror that is Elden Ring. But Tunnock isn't it? I know it's called Tunnock, by the way. No, Tunnock is not the game that I was hoping that it was going to be as impeccably beautiful as it is. You see, Tunnock is absolutely bloody rock hard, as it turns out, which I wasn't really expecting. It's amazing, but it's video game amazing in so much as that it's like a Zelda game and it's like a Dark Souls game. It looks a wee bit like Monument Valley as well, I thought, just that kind of diorama, isometric kind of look. Its influences are clear for you to see, but as I say, that doesn't detract from the fact that it is really, I know you're not supposed to say this, are you still not supposed to say this, it is really, really, really pretty looking. Look at all the light effects, look at the design of everything, it's just so satisfying. I don't exactly know why it is, I can't exactly pinpoint why it is that when you get that kind of miniaturistic feel to the game, there just becomes a enclosed kind of completeness feel to it that's very cosy. But as I've also said, that is counterbalanced by the fact that this game is fucking rock solid, which is absolutely not what you need when you're getting smashed to bits every 2 seconds in Elden Ring, but oh my god, it's so pretty. Isn't it so pretty? When I'm saying it's rock solid, I'm not just talking about the fighting, by the way. The fighting is like, it's adequate. The fighting engine is adequate, but I definitely don't find it as satisfying as Elden Ring combat. You know, a big boy grown-up game, I don't find it as satisfying as that. The engine doesn't feel as diverse. I don't feel as if I've invested in the same way. Guys just hit really hard an awful lot of the time. You get delivered a surprising amount of damage when you're fighting things. But it isn't just the combat that's tricky, the puzzles are actually surprisingly difficult to figure out. I mean, if you're old and stupid like me, they're difficult. Look, of course, Tunnock is obviously a great achievement, but what I'm saying to you is that it wasn't what I was after, because I'm already having a hard time. I appreciate that it's like signs and parts of the manual and stuff are written in like a foreign language that you don't quite understand yet. It's got a lot of different quirks to it that you'll have seen before in other games, but it's great. It's a great little game, but as I say, I'm playing Elden Ring right now, and I'm getting absolutely smashed to pieces, so I don't really need the hassle when you rest at shrines and stuff, or the enemies reset, just like in Dark Souls. As lush and impressive and as satisfying as this game is, you've got to believe that there's a Switch version coming soon. This game has got to be on Switch. It's got to be. It's a really good game. They've just borrowed an awful lot of stuff for other games as well. But that's allowed in video games. Have a fantastic weekend. When it comes.
How are you doing? So I've been rehearsing for a theatre show, and it's been big long days, and it means that for the past month, 6 weeks, I've been playing games for less time than I than in a long time. I've hardly played anything. And that's been particularly hard over this last period because Elden Ring came out. And I've been thinking a lot about how that feels to be missing out on the big game of the moment. The FOMO I've been feeling. I've played about maybe 6-7 hours at Elden Ring. Massively enjoyed it, massively excited. But then I've just not had the time. I've been coming home late at night and I've not had the chance to play. So I just heard a noise then, I was a bit scared. As I talk to you right now, it's late at night. This is when I have my downtime, have my tea. I could be playing Elden Ring just now, but I think to myself, what's the point? Because with a game like that, you want to sink into it like a big bath. And I can't do that. Don't want to just have a quick shot. What's the point? So I've been thinking a lot about what it's like to not be playing these big games when they come out. And a realisation has struck me. There's probably a lot of people out there who can't play these games. Not because they don't have the time, but because they don't have the money. We just assume, didn't we? We assume that everybody we talk to is able to play these games. We say wee flippant things like, oh, you should really try this. You should go out and get this. Elden Ring is like 50 quid. Gran Turismo is like 60 quid on PS5. Games are expensive. Very expensive. And I think it's really easy when you do review shows like this to forget that some people out there, there's no fucking way they can play the new big game when it just comes out. No chance. Some people out there, particularly fucking new, in 2022, when everybody's getting fucking pinched like fuck, when all our heating bills are going up, when the cost of living is through the fucking roof and the wages are getting lower, people are getting made redundant, and we are saying to people, you should definitely try this. Spend your 60 quid, give this a go. And I've been thinking about that as I've been boohooing to myself about the fact, oh, I'm working in the theatre, so I don't have time to play Elden Ring. Fucking shut up, man. Fucking shut up. It's a privilege to be able to play these games, to have the money, to have the money to spend on leisure like that, because there's plenty of people where 60 quid, they're having to stretch that money for that game, they're having to stretch to feed families. And it's something we probably don't talk about enough. We probably don't talk enough about how much games cost and the value of them. Now, a game like Elden Ring, I know even having played just 6 or 7 hours of it, that a game like Elden Ring is going to last you for like a year if you wanted to. You can play it all year long. But it still doesn't matter. Where does that person out there just now worrying about how they're going to pay their fucking bills from month to month find that 60 quid to throw away on that game? I don't think they do find it. So there's going to be plenty of people out there who are like me, who are seeing the discourse, reading the reviews, seeing the memes and the tweets, and feeling like I'm fucking missing out. The difference is, I've got it. It's sitting in there. I'm lucky enough that I could buy it. And there's other people out there who are thinking, maybe when the panic dies down and the games are second on, maybe then I can get it. You know? Being into video games, it all moves in waves, doesn't it? The discourse, the excitement, the thrill, and then everybody moves on to something else. And there must be people out there, and there's probably people out there who were like me or like Ryan when we were Wayne's, who, you know, we were from families that didn't have a lot of money, Bethy as well. Working class families who weren't loaded, couldn't buy every game there was. I remember the days, man. I remember the days when you had a load of fucking copied Amiga discs. Occasionally, you would get a brand new game bought for you.
but it had to last you for a good while. You fucking rinsed it. Still going to be the same for a lot of people out there just now. The only in our bubble of games journalists and all that, and the people we follow on Twitter where it's like game journals and hardcore gamers and people that collect ridiculous amount of fucking Switch games, like I did, grotesque fucking expenditure on fucking stupid games, man. There's a lot of people who are on the in that sphere. They're outside that and they're having to kind of watch it happen. And I feel like I get it this month. I feel like my eyes have been fucking opened because I can't play them. I don't know what yous are all talking about. What the fuck are yous all talking about? I don't know what yous are all talking about. It's worth thinking about. It's something worth thinking about. Now, I don't want you going to bed feeling guilty the night because you've been able to play Elden Ring. Don't feel too guilty about it. That's all right. You did that. I'm not saying you should go out and buy Elden Ring for everybody in your street. But just bear it in mind, right? Bear it in mind, you lucky bastard. You fucking lucky bastard.
Hi, I'd like to talk to you about Elden Ring, which is a game that came out in 2022. When I first turned Elden Ring on, I'm ashamed to say that I kind of felt a wee bit of cockiness because I was thinking of all the people who had rushed it and bought Elden Ring because it was the biggest game that's out right now, but they've never played a Souls game before. So I was thinking to myself, remembering the absolute torture that was playing Dark Souls 1 for the first time and not really having a clue what was happening, I was thinking, well, I at least know the moves and a lot of the items like bonfires and health flasks and weapons and stuff, I already know how the basic functionality of these things work, so I've got a bit of a head start, really. And then I thought this Margit, or as most Scottish people have been referring to this boss fight, Margit. By the time I'd gotten to this boss fight, I had already disposed of some minor bosses, but not quite any major bosses. Just soak in what you're about to see here. Just two mere hits, I would say. Two mere hits and that was it done.
His card's marked. It's definitely, it's happening. He's getting it. He's definitely getting it. Maybe not this time, but it's coming. It's coming. It's definitely coming.
Quite a lot of big talk spilling out of me while I'm streaming this game. I think it's just to paper over the hurt that I'm...
showing that boy. The reach on him.
The hurt that I'm feeling.
Piss flaps. Ah, well. Wow.
I really do need to watch myself when I'm streaming this game because I properly feel like I'm flipping it. Sometimes. I've played as much of Elden Ring as I've been able to play. I've been feeling a little bit busy. I've been noticing that quite a lot of people have been saying the same thing as me. I've been working on mental health videos with young people, and young people are saying that they're kind of overwhelmed by life, really. They don't understand how before the pandemic there was a level of productivity and activity that nowadays they just don't understand how they were capable of achieving. And I've heard loads of other different types of people from different walks of life, different age ranges, all saying the same thing. It's kind of baffling to them how they manage to not burn out. And I feel like I can also sympathise with that point of view because I've been busy, but I can remember in the past that I would be busy and a new Souls game would come out and I wouldn't care, I would be caning it to get to the end, but that's not happening this time. I've played it as much as I could play it, and I've loved it, and I've absolutely loved what I've played.
Oh, you bastard, you.
Apart from that bit, I mean, you can tell from my face that I'm loving it. As shite as I am, and as little as I've conquered of the game.
His days are numbered. I say that, but I've not even really got close to Denim. I don't. My spirit's getting crushed.
I'm absolutely blown away by Elden Ring. Blown away. It's not just the vastness of the map. It's the depth of the imagination that is within the areas. The artistic variety that you come across in this game is absolutely staggering. My adventures or misadventures in this game had me in mind a World of Warcraft. Check what happens here. You can steal this trick if you want to earn some easy runes. Fuck you, pal. Easy runes.
Oh, fuck off, you big prick.
Hey, come on now, Ryan. Come on. What are we? We're werewolves. We're werewolves. We're not swearwolves.
No offence to any big pricks out there.
Aye, my wanderings around the map have put me in mind of World of Warcraft, because I did the same thing in World of Warcraft where I adventured and basically just got squashed by absolutely everything that I fought, but I still had fun. I've still got amazing memories of going through these areas in World of Warcraft and having a really, really fun time, but my concern with that is...
My theory and how you can do this fight is that you want...
Listen to me here, pretending as if I've got some kind of strategy, as if I know what I'm doing, Mum. Just literally just winging it every single time I go through that fog wall. My concern with the adventuring but getting squashed all the time is that eventually you reach that brick wall point where you don't feel that you're making enough progress and you kind of just lose interest in playing the game. That hasn't happened with Elden Ring. And I think that hasn't happened with Elden Ring because I find the gameplay so delicious.
Fuck you, I had my shield up!
So deliciously...
I had my fucking shield up! Having a fucking shield if it doesn't do it.
I find the gameplay so delicious. I'm so well conditioned now to how Souls games work that it's almost in my DNA that I know that I just need to persevere.
That seems incredibly unfair.
Flying dangerously close to wank cat territory, but in many ways it is like life. I know. I'm familiar with the idea that all I have to do is persevere. That's it. I just need to persevere. And maybe have a biscuit as well, if I can fit the whole biscuit into my... I can fit the whole biscuit into my mouth. This game is fucking staggering. I don't mean my character gets staggered all the time, that also happens, but me in real life, I'm staggered.
Really, really hard to take that struggling to get off the grun animation.
Please understand the level of rage that I'm feeling inside my chest when I'm saying these things on the stream. I'm trying not to be a murderer, as I want to be a murderer. It's making me feel like I want to be a murderer, but I'm trying not to be a murderer. So as you can tell from this coverage, let's call it coverage of Elden Ring, it's hardly a review. It's around about the 20, 30 hour mark that I start to think to myself, I'm going to have to become comfortable with the idea that I'm going to be playing this game for a very long time. But I'm very, very far from being disappointed with that, because Elden Ring is an absolutely brilliant Souls game. And what's wrong with having an absolutely brilliant Souls game that you're going to have to be playing for the next probably 4 to 5 years before I finish it? Perseverance. If you need reassurance about Elden Ring, you've not got the Souls experience. It's perseverance. It's perseverance and allowing yourself to go at your own pace. Oh, feels good. There is no greater feeling of achievement in video games than beating something in a Souls game that you didn't think you'd ever be able to beat. And there are so many enemies in this game that you'll feel as if you'll never be able to beat. So the game is enormous, and it's beautiful, and it's really challenging. It's also incredibly rewarding and constantly astonishing, constantly taking my breath away. It's really, really special, this game. I don't really like fighting on horseback, to be honest. I do like the horse, but I've not got the hang of fighting on horseback. I find that really awkward. But I'm starting to think that this game will actually be the final game that I ever play. I think there's a good chance it's going to take me about 3 or 4 years to actually get all the way through. The rate that I'm going at, anyway. But the good thing is that I don't feel as if I'm in any rush. I don't feel as if I have to rush through this brilliant Souls game. I just feel unbelievably lucky that it's going to be there for so long every time I want to dip into it. If you've tried Souls games before and bounced off them, apologies if this coverage doesn't convince you to give it another go. The inclusion of an open world environment doesn't really change the type of experience that you're going to have too much. You're going to fucking die a lot, because this game's really hard. But it's absolutely jaw-dropping. Jaw-dropping. I still feel as if I'm hardly anywhere in the game, but I'm still saying to myself, this is one of the most astonishing things I've ever seen. We all just have to keep our fingers crossed that I'm no going to be doing Elden Ring reviews for the next 3 years. I might be doing Elden Ring reviews for the next 3 years. This game is astonishing. That's all I've got to say. Hold me close, love my soul the most. Lately I've been just what I need. Stole my heart and I gonna be my old boyfriend. Be my own boyfriend. Lately I've been just what I need. Be my baby, I'm gonna be my own boyfriend. Oh, I could save myself the stress. Wear the trousers and the dress, yeah. Girl, you look